Honorable Minister, Shri Hardeep Singh Puri, Secretary Civil Aviation, Shri Pradeep Singh Karola, distinguished guests from the media, our friends from the industry, and our guests from the Government of India. It is a matter of great honor and pride for me to welcome you all at the second edition of the Drone Festival of India. The drone industry has seen a massive growth in the last 5 years. It's an industry that came out from nowhere. We've always heard of drones that being used in the military for a very long time, but over the last 5 years, this is an industry that in civil applications and military applications has grown to almost a $100 billion industry over the last 5 years. And due to the sheer size and the scale of our nation, the size of our population, and the challenges of the growth that our country is trying to face, India is a great place where this technology can use some of these solutions. From security and surveillance applications, mining, roads, railways, first response, agriculture, entertainment, drones are being able to play a very, very strong pivotal role in a lot of these industries. And we are excited to be here to be able to discuss these opportunities and challenges. The Drone Federation came together 3 years ago with an understanding of building this industry with least amount of challenges. There are three pillars that we are working with, which is to work on policy, working on networking, which is a lot of what is happening today, and working with news and updates. It is an honor to introduce today our chief guest for the day, Minister Civil Aviation, Shri Hardeep Singh Puri. With a lot of experience in the foreign services, he has been in the United Nations as the president of the United Nations Security Council and the chairman of the United Nations Counterterrorism Committee as well. Today, he holds independent charge as the Minister of Civil Aviation, Housing and Urban Development, Ministry of Commerce and Industry. With such a deep understanding of global affairs and a vast international experience, it is an honor to invite you on stage to say a few words.
What's your name?
Rahul Kutri.
Good morning to all of you. When the gentleman who just introduced me met me outside and welcomed me here, he said that something to the effect that drones will constitute a small part of the work which we do in the Civil Aviation Ministry. And I wanted to correct him there, and I think I did mention to him, and I'm saying this on record, it may be a small part of our overall work in the Civil Aviation Ministry, but believe me, it's one of the most challenging tasks that any ministry can have. And therefore, I welcome this interaction with you. On the 13th of this month, that is a week from now, we will begin the process of registering drones. I have always believed that our skies, in general, civil aviation in particular, are a critical driver of our economic growth. But let me tell you, drones will form a very important part of that growth trajectory. A reference was made just now to drones constituting, if I remember correctly, a $100 billion industry. The point to note is that this so-called $100 billion industry has grown in terms of time in a very, very short period. These drones represent a revolution in technology. And I believe that when you write the history of this period, and in the recording of history, 10, 20 years is a very short period, drones will come to define a very fundamental change in the way we live and conduct our existence. Drones can be cost reducing, they can reduce resources, time taken, and risk of operations in various fields. I was asking the secretary just before I started this session with you, I said, how many drones are there in the country? And his estimate is close to 600,000 or 6 lakhs. And this is a situation when the process of registration has not even begun. I can see the application of drones in about every field of human endeavor. I have independent charge of two ministries, housing and urban affairs, and I can tell you, one can envisage, and we are using drones in almost every part of our work in the housing and urban affairs ministry. Similarly, we are going through an election phase. Well, we are, as a country, we're almost perpetually in an election phase till the time comes when we have one election and then rest for 5 years. But that will require a little bit of doing. As far as my party is concerned, we would prefer to do it once in 5 years. Drones are used in election rallies. Drones are used in the construction industry, in agriculture, mining, the entertainment industry. Drones have a very significant, and I would say a path-breaking role that they can play in security-related issues, in the country's economy and employment generation, and they affect every segment of the value chain. In design, manufacturing, operations, information technology, communications, maintenance, and training, etc. The Survey of India is utilizing drones to map the country with extreme accuracy. A major consequence of the drone-based exercise is the mapping of settled habitations and villages. Based on these, residents will finally be able to get property cards as well as proper legal titles to their lands. This constitutes, at the very least, a mini revolution. I can tell you, many years ago, when I was a civil servant and I was a joint secretary in one of the central ministries, we wanted to use satellite-based imagery for some of our developmental work. And even then, some of it was available in the public domain, the rest you could, you know, contract, and there are specialized agencies which do this. Today I can tell you, as we are in the process of conferring ownership rights to about 40 to 50 lakh of our citizens who live in so-called unauthorized colonies, this kind of technology is extremely helpful. The very fact that we have been able to upload the maps of nearly 1731 colonies utilizing technology, and let me tell you, no matter what function you perform, medical services, you could have envisaged a situation where a drone can come and deliver medicines at short notice where they are required. And drones come in all shapes and sizes, from 250 grams to, I believe, 2,500 kilos. I don't know, maybe they are, the range is even larger than that. These drone operations are covered by the DGCA Civil Aviation Requirements, or CAR, of August 2018. We are working to improve this process. The DGSKI's beta portal is live for registration of manufacturers, operators, pilots, and remotely piloted aircraft. This is now being developed into a full-fledged digital platform. But if you take a broad view of what is happening, I believe the total number of manufacturers registered is just 2 as yet. And now when we begin the digital online registration of drones, I believe we have the ecosystem ready so that the entire process of registration and the coming into being of implementing regulations will follow very quickly. Now, clearly, whenever you are devising a new ecosystem, there will have to be a balance between security considerations and commercial considerations. It stands to reason that you will have to draw a judicious balance between the two. If you allow your security considerations to outweigh all other considerations, I think the concerned agencies would naturally, that's their job, turn the whole country into a red area for non-operation. But at the same time, the potential uses of this technology for commercial purposes is so high that that would have to be also very important. So we are developing a system whereby we are moving ahead on the beyond visual line of sight, or BVLOS, front. Experiments will be carried out later this month. Draft CAR will be developed by DGCA and shared with stakeholders for feedback. CAR 2.0 will revolutionize, as it will have provisions for commercial BVLOS operation. We will have a database for all drones in India. This will be done through an easy online process based on trust. We will be making informed choices while making policies and regulations. Since this has to be a seamless operation of manned and unmanned aircraft in the increasingly crowded Indian skies, we are working on the policy for unmanned aircraft system traffic management for short. We clearly need to build safeguards into the full-fledged, before the full-fledged commercial operationalization takes place. Because the technology is so advanced that you could have a system where 95 or 99% of the operations are covered, but if one drone gets through and penetrates the security safeguards, you could have havoc caused. And therefore, I believe that the system we are following of slow but sure and deliberated forward movement is the correct method. We will have a system where, unless you have permission, and this has to be electronically embedded in the chip, unless the drone has permission to fly to a particular area, or as soon as it tries to transgress and moves outside the area, the permission would stand withdrawn and the drone would have to, that is the unmanned aircraft would have to come back. So let me conclude by saying that when it comes to the drone industry and India's potential, thinking big is not an option. Thinking big is something that we will do. We have the potential to become global leaders in this industry, both in terms of conceptualization, design, manufacture, and operations. And I believe that the potential we have in terms of engineering, innovation, and entrepreneurship is something that will equip us to do very well. I'm particularly enthused because of the energy and foresight of many young drone entrepreneurs that I get to meet these days, and I find when I look around the hall, they are also in a majority here. I'm not suggesting that those of my generation don't have a role, but I think their role should be of mentoring and allowing the next generation to go forward. Policy making in the Ministry of Civil Aviation and Drones involves a lot of interaction with industry and academia, and therefore, in spite of a punishing schedule this morning, I was particularly keen that I come here and spend a few minutes, and I do apologize that I have to be leaving very soon for another public event, but let me wish your deliberations the very best. I hope out of this session will come some good ideas, and you have the senior management of the ministry present here. They will take those ideas, and that this will be a continuous process of interaction. Thank you very much and have a very good day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. I would now request our guest of honor, Shri Pradeep Singh Kharola, Secretary, Ministry of Aviation, to say a few words to the gathering. I will also request Mr. Neil Mehta, Treasurer, Drone Federation of India, to join Mr. Rahat on stage and felicitate our guest with a token of gratitude.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Drone Federation of India, we would like to thank the Ministry of Civil Aviation for their grateful support in organizing this event, and especially Honorable Minister Puri and Secretary Kharola for gracing this event with their presence and sharing their vision with the industry. So we'll just like to give a token of our appreciation to both of them.
Honorable Minister Sir, President, Drone Federation of India, all my friends, ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely happy to be here this morning participating in this workshop. If you really look back and see, the last decade has been revolution by mobile technology. Go a decade back, you will see revolution by internet. Further back, revolution by laptops. Before that, computerization. A decade ago, space technology. Before that, nuclear technology. So every decade, technology has bringing in some revolution. And if I may say, the coming decade is going to be revolutionized by drones. But looking at the previous three decades, the revolution was on the soft side. Information technology, communications, computing powers, computers. Drone is definitely all of them put together, but slightly more than that. It has got physical dimensions. A drone can move through the air and reach any place. And the best part of it, it need not be manned. The machine need not be manned. Of course, it can be operated, it can be autonomous also. Now, this throws up immense amount of opportunities and at the same time, huge amount of challenges. Opportunities, I'm sure. I would like to just confine my talk to three things. Number one is opportunities. Number two is developing the ecosystem. And the third is the challenges, the safety and the security challenges. Looking at opportunities, the president just mentioned that the field can be transportation, deliveries, surveillance, and so on. But what we are looking forward is a bigger technology, as drones would be in the world in billions. India should emerge as being in the forefront of drone manufacturing. Manufacturing of drone entails two things. Number one is the hardware part of it. Number two is the software part of it. India already is a software giant. So therefore, as far as the putting the programs in the drone is concerned, definitely India will have a role. And even today, I'm sure that though the drones are being manufactured in all parts of the world, the program somewhere is getting embedded in one of the Indian cities. But the real challenge would be, how do we bring manufacturing drones in India? Now, this is a challenge which all of us have to put our hands together, heads together, and raise to the occasion that India emerges as a manufacturing hub of drones in the world. So far, the handicap has been we don't have the numbers. But I'm sure that we are working towards a system where we will have the numbers, and with economies of scale, India would become the right place for manufacturing of drones. So my first request on this occasion would be that we all should gear up for manufacturing of drones. Software, I said that we already have the capability. We start with assembling the drones. We can then come to manufacture of small components of the drone, and then to the more complex components like the motors or the batteries. And a day is not far away when the entire drone would get manufactured in India. So this is the biggest opportunity. The second one is, not the opportunity, is the design of the ecosystem. To give an example, today we have about 700 aeroplanes flying in Indian skies. And we have got an extremely robust system which monitors all these aircraft online second to second.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Just imagine a scenario. We have just 700 aircraft, or say 1,000 aircraft flying today, but the number of drones even today, every day, must be running into hundreds of thousands. The challenge is, how do we make an ecosystem to regulate these drones? In a just interaction I had a few days, I said that the best way to develop a regulatory mechanism is compare drones to, say, a car or an automobile. But a drone is much more than that. For a car or a vehicle, we have got today a robust Motor Vehicles Act, the Motor Vehicles Rules, and the regulations issued by various state governments, which govern various aspects of the manufacture, the registration, the sale, and the use of cars. We should also move in the same direction. First thing we should do is that let's have a system where it would be possible to capture the information about the drones, see to it they conform to standards. Before this will come that we'll have to lay down the standards, a very uphill task. Once they conform to standards, then we license them. The same thing would also happen to the drone operators. Today you have a system of driving license for each driver. So we will have something, a similar concept for drones also, a license for the drone operator. And then we, as only a licensed driver can drive a registered car, in the same way a licensed operator would be able to fly a registered drone. So that's how we are trying to evolve a system like that. And as Honorable Minister just mentioned, that the first step would be that as we are already lagging behind. And the first step we are doing is, let's at least capture the details of existing drones and the drone operators. So shortly we'll have a system, our electronic system would be up and working, and we would be able to, as a first step, register all the drones and all the drone owners in the country. Now this does not mean that they have been licensed. After this has been done, then we can develop filters which will convert this registration into licenses. So this is about the static part of the ecosystem. The more challenging is going to be the dynamic part of ecosystem. Now this is where the difference comes between a drone and a car. A car can just move on the roads. A drone moves in three dimensions. It does not require a road. And therefore, we will have to create electronically roads, traffic lights, and traffic policemen for drones. And all this will have to be electronic. So when I say that we have to move into dynamic ecosystem, is this is what the dynamic system is going to be. Honorable Minister was just mentioning the NPNT concept. No permission, no takeoff. That will be an essential ingredient of the dynamic ecosystem of our drone philosophy. This is where we are facing big challenges. So for right now, we stand at only, in about a week time, we will reach the registration. Then we sit together with all of you and work towards converting this registration into a static ecosystem that will be graduating from registration to licensing. And then we have to work on the dynamics. how do we track the drones? Where all would the drones be allowed to fly? How do we permit drones to move? Now, all this is going to be a huge Herculean task, and for which already experiments are going on. We are interacting with each one of you. But now, I think I would say that the activities are going to be very fast. And shortly, our digital sky would be operational. And simultaneously, we'll also be working on the rules and regulations to ensure that all the drones which we are using conform to the safety and the security standards. And with this, I come to the third aspect, is the safety and the security. Needless to say, all drones have to be safe. If drones have to be safe, they have to be licensed. But then we have to build up once again some operating procedure or some specifications, some parameters. If the drone conforms to those parameters, would we be able to certify that a drone is safe? Same thing, if you go to motor vehicle rules, you will see that there is a list of specifications given in the motor vehicles rules to which an automobile should conform, and then only is it registered. Something similar we have to do for the drones also, but this is once again going to be much more complex. But I'm sure in today's deliberations and interactions henceforth, we will come up with such solutions that we develop specifications, and these specifications could be quite generic ones, which would then we will convert these specifications into regulations, and if the drones are matching these regulations, we certify the drone to be safe. This is again the easier part of it. Drones to be secure. Now, drones have huge potential. They can go anywhere. They can do some spying. They can do some surveillance. They can even do some intrusive activities. Now, that's where the problem comes. How do we ensure that the civilian drones which we are taking care of are very secure? Which means that these drones should not be capable of doing any mischief. Now, this again has to be incorporated by putting some specifications into the hardware, into the regulations, and into the software. NPNT is one part of it. Evolving safe corridors is second part of it. And third is having testing labs and quality control labs through which these drones would pass to ensure that they have all these security related features embedded in it. Now, once this is done, then we would be able to say that, and of course, then we have to design the entire digital platform which will be supporting, monitoring, and regulating all these drones. Once all that is done, would we be able to say that we have built up a good, congenial ecosystem for the drones? And I'm sure that if we do that, we would be one of the leading countries to have done it, because even the developed countries are still struggling with it. Most of the countries allow flight of drones, but having a regulatory mechanism where we'll be able to track each and every drone. Now, this is going to be a tall order, but one day definitely we'll be saying that you will have to incorporate features in the drones which allow each drone to be tracked. Now, there are cost implications. How do we overcome it? What are the various solutions? Some experiments and research have to go in this direction also. So once that is done, then I would say that we would have met all the three. I'd say that the three aspects is that the opportunities, yes, we become a big manufacturer of drone. Number two is we develop an ecosystem, both static and dynamic. And number three is we have a system where the drone systems are secure so that the rogue drones get identified. Though neutralization of rogue drones will not be part of the civilian affair, but at least the identification part of it will come within our system. So all these are the challenges, and it's a very exciting area, exciting time to work, and I'm sure that with all these young people sitting over here, we will soon have large number of drones being manufactured, large number of, and all of them being compliant to our specifications. We will soon come up with this with all these specifications, and then putting all this together, we will have a very good electronic based regulatory mechanism where entire thing should be machine driven, leaving nothing to human intervention. So I'm sure that these are the small, the baby steps we are taking, and we are open to discussions, and I'm sure that we have very useful deliberations today and tomorrow, and we'll be looking forward to the recommendations which emanate out of this workshop. But my request to all of you would be, please focus on the aspects which I have just mentioned, as let these become the guiding force of the path we want to take in making India a major hub of drone manufacturing and usage. So thank you very much.